Hi everyone, it's Mike here. So don't forget to click that subscribe and bell icon to receive a notification each time I upload a new video. Hi everyone, it's Mike here and welcome back to my YouTube channel. So today I'm getting ready for the new year, for 2021. So next year I plan on creating some smaller sized collage artworks, and I wanted to do them in a small journal. So the journal size that I wanted to work in is a 4x6 inch, so it's almost postcard size or thereabouts. So what I want to do is I'm going to make the journal myself, but it's not going to be like a hardbacked cover or anything like that. It's just going to be mixed media or watercolor cardstock that I'm going to cut down into some leaves and then stitch together into one big signature. Well, say a big signature, just one signature. So, but I'm going to decorate it as well. So what I'll do is I'll turn over to my overhead camera and I'll show you in a little bit more depth what I intend to do. Okay, so as I said earlier, I was going to make the cover and the signatures out of watercolor or mixed media cardstock. Now, the one that I'm using myself here today is the De La Rowney mixed media for multi-techniques, which is 250 GSM or £169. And I'm cutting the sheets out from that. So this is just a small pad. You can get it in larger sizes, but any kind of watercolor cardstock or mixed media cardstock would do the trick. So the piece that I've cut is actually, this is going to be the cover piece. So I've cut it larger than, well, it should be normally 8 if you're going to do a 4x6 journal, but I've made it so it's bigger so that I've got more of an overlap for the cover and all the pages are going to be on the inside. So this one I've measured out at 9 and, let's have a look, 1, 2, 3, maybe 9.5, just about 9.5, and then height wise again, it's just over 6.5. It doesn't really matter. As long as it's bigger than the pieces of paper or the cards that will fit inside a 6x4. Now, have I got a piece already cut by 6x4? Let me have a look. He says running to the other side of the craft room. Right, I think this is actually cut to 4x6. Near enough. It is 4x6. So when I create the 4x6 pieces, it will fit nicely with a border all the way around. But this is the cover piece. So the pieces, your leaves or your pages of your signature, want to be just a little bit smaller than that. Height-wise, it doesn't make any difference, but width-wise, it does, because when you've got two or three together, they will tend to push forward. It's called creep. So if I've got those there, let me show you that, so I can get it the right way around. There we go. And get some more pages all together, all cut to the same size. Now, when you fold these together, because you've got the width of all the pieces there, it will push forward the centerpiece. Now, can you see the difference in the lengths on the inside? That's called creep. Now, you could, if you wanted to, when you've got all your pieces together, you could then go back in and start cutting those down to make it so that it's level once you've got it in your signature. But I'm not going to do that. So I've made sure that my cover is wide enough to cover all of it anyway. So I'm allowing the creep. Now, the reason I've done that is because if you start cutting down the inner pages to compensate for the thickness at the spine, you're going to end up with a smaller piece. So as you get to the center of the journal, it's going to get smaller and smaller and smaller, and you're going to end up with a piece which is probably less than 4 inches, which is why I don't want to do it. Just a little tip there for you. So if you want to do it, make sure your covers are bigger. They don't have to be height-wise, because that's, you know, you don't really need to do it that way. I did cut one down so that it did sit perfectly in the middle. That would be the one there. So when you close it, it should be... Yeah, I think that's pretty much where I want them to be. But I'm going to work on the cover first before I stitch any of this together. And all I'm going to do is, I've already marked on it front and back, so I don't know whether the camera's picking that up or whether it's too bright. So I've got front and back. I've already marked my places where I'm going to prick through to stitch. So these are going to be the front cover and the back cover. So to get started on the decoration, before I waffle off too much and start confusing everybody, is I've cut two pieces of William Morris paper. This is from the book that I told you about the other week that I purchased from the Victoria and Albert Museum, that had the CD inside with all of the William, well, a lot of the William Morris patterns on the CD for you to use in your personal project. So, and I've just created or printed off a couple of pieces for the front and back. And all I'm going to do is, well, first of all, I want to distress the edges. So I've got some vintage photo distress ink, he says. So I just want to go around. So this journal that I'm going to create, the intention is that I'm going to create a collage journal, and each of the pieces of collage or that's going to go in here, I'm going to create separately then stick in. So this will form like the basis, the book, and then each time I create a 6x4, so a 4x6 collage piece, it's all going to be on the same sort of theme. They're not all going to be kind of disparate and all wildly varying. They're all going to be, I'll follow a theme all the way through the journal. And I'm hopefully, or the intention is, to do this on a regular basis over the entire of 2021. So it'll be a year-long journal, and I will probably do the minimum of one project in this journal per month right the way through 2021. So starting with the first one in January, or if the mood takes me and I get struck by inspiration, I may do the first one between Christmas and New Year. Because once the journal's created, there's nothing stopping me from jumping in and actually starting to do the pages. I've already done some prep for this journal, as in what I want to do going forward next year. I'm just going to take that. It's a bit of dried glue, just covering the nozzle opening. There we go. So I've already done some prep, like I've just said. So I know pretty much what direction I'm going to go with this, but I have actually over-prepped. Because I said originally that I was going to do this maybe like once a month, with that in mind, the thought was, well, I only need to do 12. When I started to do the prep for this, I got so carried away that I ended up prepping for about 16 and then it went on to 20. So it might be that I might just push it and do and prep for 24, which means I could probably squeeze one in once a fortnight. So that's going to be the base for the front, so we'll do the same for the back. The glue I'm using is the Elmer's Purple, which dries completely clear, which I recently discovered, and it's absolutely marvellous, and it's inexpensive as well. So, and the fact that it's got a fine point applicator on it is an even bigger bonus. Okay, so I'm using the William Morris paper. It doesn't really have an up and a down, but I'm going to put it the same anyway. So we've got the same on the front as we have on the back. Okay, so that's going to be the front, and that one's going to be the back. Right, so I did say this was going to be a collage journal. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to decorate the front first, and then I'm going to stitch all the other signatures inside. Because it's going to be easier to do it flat than trying to work with the bulk of the actual journal itself. So I've got here some bits and pieces of ephemera that I've gathered together that I want to use. I've also got some washi tapes. There was three washi tapes, but I've also got a photograph to go on the front of the journal. Now, the journal theme is going to be the Rogues Gallery. So it's going to feature vintage photographs in there throughout the year. Let's call it Rogues Gallery. The odd female face may appear in there as well, so we'll just use the word rogue as a generic term. So to start off with then, I've got my photograph. Now this is 60 millimeters by 90. I'm going to try and do them all the same kind of size. So you're looking at almost 2.5 by almost 3.5, so ATC sized. That's how big these photographs are going to be. And again, I'm going to distress the life out of every single one, either with distress ink or physically distressing it with a scruffer. But we'll see how that goes. To start off with, the front cover, I'm not going to do any kind of scruffing on it. I'm just going to go around everything and distress. And then I'm going to build up like a collage cluster to go on the front. Now, I know a lot of you like watching my collage when I do the clusters. That looks so much better with those distressed edges, doesn't it? Okay, so I've also got some reproduction ephemera from my digi collection that I've printed off. Sure what the date is on that one. Oh, 1873 it says. Temperance Fete. So it's a reproduction of an old temperance poster from London. I thought it was Victorian. I'd never noticed it. Well, I suppose 1873. Was it Victorian? Oh, I can't remember. Okay, so I've also got a little bit from the bottom of a boxing poster. Going to use for layering. I've also got a piece of ledger paper. I'm hoping you can see that. So that's ledger paper, but I want to tear that. Don't want a straight edge on that one. Okay. This is going to be my base piece. So this is what's going to go down next. So we can get that glued on once we've got all this distressed up. The good thing about using pieces of ephemera like this is that if you've digitized them, then you're not using it up. You've got it, and you can use it and use it and use it and use it and use it. So this is going to go down on the front there so we can get the glue. And then the other pieces that I've got, like I said, are basically for layering and creating those fantastic kind of vintage cluster layers, which are lots of fun to create. Okay, so the reason I'm using wet glue on this is so I've got wiggle room. So let's bring that up a little bit. There we go. Okay, so these next pieces, I want to try and layer on here, but they're going to go behind the photograph. Let's move that up there. Let's see, about there and like so, which is just right. But I also want to add in some washi tape. So I'm going to add in some washi tape about so there, just to kind of get that kind of layering feel going. So I want to also add some just at the back of here, going there. So I can put some about there, like that. So like that, and then that can go over the top like so. Maybe just add one more piece so that it comes just a small bit, I think. So that it goes just underneath there. So we'll add that like so. Okay, so now we can start creating our first bit of clustering. So we'll add this one on. And then when I've done this, I'll show you what my inspiration was for this little journal. The reason I'm not showing you just yet is because I want you to just see how I create it first of all. And then I'll show you how you can pretty much replicate go through the same kind of process, but get it to look different each time. Maybe not far enough out, so this is why I like using the wet glue, so you can actually maneuver stuff before you actually set it down. Okay, so let's get some glue on the back of that. You can pre-build your clusters if that's easier for you than just lay the entire thing down as one. But about there, wasn't it? Yeah. Like that. Excellent. Okay, so I've got a couple of other little pieces of ephemera just to add a few points of interest and some highlights. See, in the background of this paper, I don't know whether the camera's picking it up, but there are some kind of like reddish berries. So I want to just bring that to the foreground just by using a couple of like red highlights on this. So this is an old vintage advert for razors. It's tiny. It's almost like one of the Tim Holtz snippets. Let's put that down there like so. And And then I'll postage stamp. Put a little glue on there. And then I'm going to put that just in that corner there. Okay, now the trick with these kind of things is creating your visual triangle with your collage items. Now, I've got three pieces of washi tape there that will help draw the eye around the page. I'm also adding in three pieces of red ephemera, just small pieces of red ephemera, which adds a second visual triangle on your page. So this one's just got a random number on it. Well, it's not a random number. It does have some meaning to me, but nobody else. Okay. So if I put that there, so that it's breaking out of my portrait photo, you've also got that visual triangle there as well. So you've got two visual triangles. It all helps draw the eye around the page to discover those points of interest. Okay, so I think that's going to do it for my cluster for this page, but I want to add a title. So this is going to be called my Rogues Gallery. So I'll get some glue and add that onto the back. And that's going to go down there like so. Okay, and I'm happy with the way that that front cover looks for the journal. So I want to give it a minute or so just to kind of dry before I then start adding and stitching the other signatures into my little mini journal. So I'm going to pop you on hold. I forgot what I was going to say, then too busy looking at the rest of the desk. I'm going to pop you on hold for a second. For you, it'll just be a second. For me, it'll be about half an hour while this sets and dries. So I'll be right back. Okay, confession time. I actually wanted to stop to have a cup of coffee because, you know, rocket fuel and all that. There we go. So I'm now revitalised and caffeine to the nines again. Right, so front cover has had plenty of time to dry. So as I said before, I've marked my three spaces where I want to stitch. I have actually already gone through and put holes ready for stitching, just to make things a little bit easier. All I'm going to be doing is just bog standard three hole pamphlet stitch, and there are 1,001 videos on YouTube by other people showing you how to do that. So I'm not really going to do a stitching tutorial, but because I'm only going to be doing the one, you're going to see me do it anyway. So I've already pricked through all the other leaves for my signature. As you can see, needles all go through, which is fine. And as long as I line all those up, they're all going to be in the right place. So there we go. Easy. Right, so I've got some bookbinding thread. It's just linen thread, which has already been waxed. But me being me, I like to add a little bit more wax on just to make it a little bit easier to go through so that it slides through the holes far easier. So wax on, haha, wax off. No, we're not going there, are we? So through once. Now I like to have my my knot on the outside of the journal normally when I'm stitching, because when I'm doing a hard cover journal, it usually gets covered up. This isn't going to do that, so I'm going to try and do it so that the knot is in the middle this time. So, which is not something that I normally do. So I'm going to go through the middle hole first. Make sure I've left a decent tail of the thread. I probably should have used a different coloured thread, shouldn't I really? But just so you could see it. And then I'm going to try and go back through. This is where it gets a bit difficult, because you never line up your holes perfectly, which is why it's always best to leave a long tail. Right, so that's through there, that's through there. Do we go all the way through one at a time, because it's thick card? Oh, you see, it just causes so many different... No, it doesn't really. Because we're only using a few sheets, it's easy just to go through, line your holes up, and then you can just pretty much go through one at a time if you want. There we go. So now we're going back through those, just pull that a bit tighter, and we can pull through. Okay, so pull outwards, never pull inwards, because if you pull that way, you're going to end up ripping your card. So if you pull outwards, the tension is out and not going to cause you any problems. So you can then adjust, then I'm going to flip that round, and then we're going to go back out again. That was a bit easier, he says, pulling the thread out of his needle. But because it's wax linen thread and it's kind of a large needle, it doesn't make any difference. We'll just pop it back in again like that. And then through. And then I'm just going to just gently pull. That's it. And then we're going to go back through the same hole again. There we go, back into the middle. I just pull all the way through like that. Okay, so now we've got our threads in the middle. It's nice and tidy on the outside. I'm going to put one of the threads either side, like so. And again, I'm pulling outwards, just get a bit of tension on it, and then I'm going to knot it. Now, as you're pulling your knot tight, put some tension on it, because that will help keep that tension as you're going down. And then I'm going to knot it one more time, put the tension on it, pull it down, and then just grab your scissors and then just trim it off like so. And your little journal is now all stitched together. So in this one, I'll probably end up covering the insides as well. So we've actually got 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 19, 20, 21, 22. So there's actually 22 surfaces there to work on. 23 if you also count the back cover. So over the process of the year, I will go through and I will continue to add clusters like this all the way through the book until it's complete. Now, I did say I was going to show you the inspiration for this. So this is my version, and I'm going to pull in this one here. So this is a piece created by a friend, Eric Bruth, who you may know. Eric lives in France, lives in Paris, and he created this recently, and I loved it, absolutely loved it. And I thought, you know what? This is going to be my inspiration to create an entire journal using these kind of clusters for the entire one. Now, I wanted to do the front cover as a mirror image of what Eric's created, just to show you that you can get totally different effects by varying your colour schemes. So exactly the same layout, but I've changed the colours, I've mixed and matched the colours. So obviously the next few pages that I do in this, there'll be different layouts. But I wanted to show you that Eric was the one that inspired the front cover with his piece. I'm not really sure how big this is. So thank you, Eric, for inspiring me to create my journal for 2021. Okay, so that's it then. So all I have to do now is to start adding in my pages in this journal. So we're going to be calling this the Rogues Gallery Journal. So I hope you've enjoyed watching me create that journal for 2021. If you have, please remember to give the video a thumbs up, share it with your friends, and if you haven't subscribed to my YouTube channel already, you can do so by clicking the button at the end of the video. I'd like to say a huge thank you to all of my angels, because without you, particularly this year, these videos would not be possible. Thank you very much. That's all from me for now. I'll see you all again very soon. Bye for now.